In fact, God, we thank you for letting us meet you here this morning. We thank you for blessing us with safe travel. And Father, we ask that you would open our ears, our hearts, our minds, our eyes, that we may hear what it is you're trying to say to us, that we may see what it is you're trying to say to us, that we may receive what it is you're trying to say to us. Speak in such a way that changes us, that transforms us from who we are to who you want us to be. We thank you, God, and we love you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. All right, so if you could please do like me and find the PFBC live stream on Facebook or YouTube, and then click the share button and share it to your page. That would be great. That would help us out greatly if you could please do that for us. Those of you who are here, if you're joining with us online, thank you for tuning in today. We ask that you would please like and share this particular live stream so that we can get the word out to more and more people. Amen. Amen. All right, let me go on and share. And once again, if you don't know how to share it, just find somebody younger than you and they will show you how to do it. Trust me, they will. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. They will definitely show you how to do it. All right. So we are continuing in our series, Living in the Overflow, Living in the Overflow. And so we are on the last message of this series, which I said before is going to take us a few weeks to get through. And this is Radical Generosity. Part two. You guys were trying to hurry up and get out of here last week, so I didn't get a chance to finish. So we're gonna try to finish this part up this week. Amen. Amen. Second Corinthians eight, which is, and again, all of this is on your handout. 2 Corinthians 8. Verses 1 through 7, it says, "And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace for I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us." "That you also excel in this," underline, "grace of giving." Amen. And so this is Radical Generosity Part 2. Now, we covered a lot of this last week, and there's nuggets of things in here that we won't cover until next week. And I'm actually tempted to go into it now that I've read it again, but we'll save some of this stuff for next week. So what we talked about last week, and again, all this is on your handout, radical generosity. Radical generosity is about attitude and not amount. It's about attitude and not amount. So when we start talking about radical generosity, we're talking about an attitude rather than an amount. I need you to say that with me. We are talking about an attitude, a way of thinking, the way we see it, how we process it, not the amount, never the amount. It's not the amount. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, I told you this is about attitude. It's about how you think. It's about how you see it. Don't come up in here and confuse what we're doing and make this about money. Because this is not about money. This is about how you think. Understand me? Right? We good? Right? So when we start talking about generosity, radical generosity, it's not about money. It's about attitude. And so we looked at this. Number two, God is not trying to make us tithers. He's not trying to make us tithers. And again, you'll probably never go, you probably won't go to another church in America and hear that. But he's not. God is not trying to make us tithers. What God is trying to do is make us givers. And again, we'll come back and look at that and examine what a giver is and all of that. But that's really what he's trying to do. He's not trying to make us tithers. He's trying to make us givers. Because when God makes us givers, he makes us who he is. Are you with me? Like when you look at God in the totality of who he is, God is not a tither. He's not a tither. His command is for us to be like him. And God doesn't give you 10% of life. He doesn't give you 10% of blessing. It's not who he is or what he does. It's not how he functions or how he operates. God is a giver. Anybody understand what I'm talking about? Like he doesn't forgive you for 10% of your sins. That's not what he does. God is a giver. There's a song that came out years ago that said, you know, God is a God of a second chance. No, he's not. If you're like me, you used up your second chance a long time ago. He is not the God of a second chance. He is the God of another chance. Because he is a giver. And so what we looked at last week was the formula. There's a formula to this thing. And the formula is God gives to us. Some we keep, some we give back to God. God gives to us again, then gives us more than we give. Some we keep, some we give back to God, then we repeat the process. Are you with me? And then it says, number three, the more we give, and this is the exciting part, the more we give, the more we get to give. Right? The more we give, the more we get to give. Kids often don't figure out that the more responsible they are, the more you will give them to be responsible for. Right? And God is much the same way. When God can trust you, he'll give you more he can trust you with. So the more we give, the more we get to give. Is everybody cool with that? All right. Now, here we go. Back to the text. If you look at the text, there's something I just want to point out a little bit. In the first part of the text, it says, and now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. Again, back to that word, grace. And again, I told you the story of what happened last week. I'll just reiterate it quickly. There was a set of churches, or a church, rather, in the city of Jerusalem. And that church was going through... they were experiencing some deep financial struggles. And what Paul is doing is he's talking to the Corinthian church, and what he's trying to do is he's trying to raise an offering for the churches or for the church or the churches in Jerusalem. And so he's talking to the Corinthian church, trying to get them to raise an offering to give to the church in Jerusalem, because the church in Jerusalem is going through a very difficult time. And while he's trying to talk to the Corinthian church about giving an offering, he's using as an example or as a talking point these other churches in an area called Macedonia. And he's telling Paul about what the Macedonian churches did for the church in Jerusalem. And then he's saying, if they can do that, come on. You can, come on. And so here's how he gets it. And now, brothers and sisters, I want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, right? In the midst of big problems, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up into rich generosity. So here's what Paul is saying. You guys are kind of this fat cat kind of church. Like you don't have the same problems or poverty that the Macedonian church has. We have a whole nother church in Jerusalem, and I need to take an offering to them because they're having hard times. And you guys, I need you guys to contribute, is what he's telling the Corinthian church. And then he uses as an example, he says, man, let me tell you about some other churches. He says, I got churches down in the place called Macedonia. And when I tell you they have a lot of problems, matter of fact, they're having more problems than the churches in Jerusalem. And they have extreme poverty. They are actually poorer than the churches that we're going to take up an offering and give to. But there's something about them that in the middle of their problems and their poverty, God did something to them. And you got to see, and you, when you read Paul, you got to watch, because Paul's a scholar. So his literary genius is amazing. What Paul does is like he juxtaposes, different themes, right? And so he says this. He says in their, he calls it in their severe trial, right? He says in their severe, in the midst of their severe trial, then it's almost like he would say something other than what he says next. But you got to juxtapose it. He says their severe trial and then overflowing joy. Then he says their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. Corinth, what you have to understand, these churches in Macedonia don't look like what they've been through. And in the midst of the big problems, God adds joy. And then they have severe poverty, extreme poverty. In the middle of extreme poverty, they end up being extremely generous. Did you get it? Question. How much joy do you have in the middle of your problems? how much joy, comes out of you when life squeezes you? See, I've said this for years. Christians, we're weird. We're weird. Because Christians, oftentimes, we look one way when we're actually opposite of what we look like. And here's how I've said that. Christians are like tea bags. You don't know what flavor you have until you pour some hot water on it. When the hot water is applied, all of a sudden you discover what the aroma is coming out of this bag. And it's interesting that Paul is making, he's making an example of poor people and saying that if poor people can do this, you should be able to do this. But you know what I've discovered? I've discovered that often rich people are the least generous people. No, listen, let me say it this way. Historically rich people are the least generous people. Historically, listen, people who have been through something are often way more generous than people who've never been through anything. Why is that though? Because when you've experienced trouble, you know what it's like to need a blessing. And because you know what it's like to need a blessing and you see somebody else in need, when the joy of God is bubbling up inside of you and you're not controlled by your circumstances, and you know, have you ever been in a situation where you didn't like the place you were in, but you knew it wasn't going to last forever? Anybody ever been there? Where you didn't like what this was, but you knew you were where you were, but you weren't where you were going. Anybody, you know what I'm talking about? And in the middle of that, when God adds joy, when we begin to believe God for something greater than where we are, meaning my current circumstance does not define me, even in the middle of that circumstance, joy has a way of welling up. When joy wells up and I see somebody else in need, struggling the way I struggle, struggling and needing something that I've needed in the past, let me hurry up and run you this help because I know what it feels like. So he says their extreme poverty, their severe trial, this thing, it wells up in rich generosity. This led us to the conclusion, and this is where we talked about last week, that poverty is no excuse for a lack of generosity. Right? And I think God had Paul put this in here just for those of us who struggle and think that we cannot be generous because we don't have means. And so Paul puts it in here. There's no such thing as poverty being an excuse for a lack of generosity. Watch this. Then we talked about the difference between bad thinking and good thinking, because here's the bad thinking. We often think that money given is money gone. That's not the proper way to think. Proper thinking is that money given is money planted. And so we kind of went and talked about the whole planting and all of that stuff. We visited the farm and all that, talked about that last week. And we talked about how you have to be careful not to eat your seed. Remember all that? Okay, now, the question is this. Pastor, I hear you. I get you. Now, but what do I do? Because I hear what you're saying. I do. And I see the text. I do. But Pastor, I ain't there. I'm not there. See, Pastor, what you don't get is that, like, you don't live with me. So, like, you know what I mean? Like, at the end of the month, you know what I mean? Like you don't see what I see. You know what I mean? Like, because I have, like, when I tell you, I for some of us, when I tell you I barely have enough, like, I barely have enough. Like, do you know that I got here this morning on prayers? You know, like I'm here, but I'm kind of not here because I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to get home. Pastor, like I hear what you're saying, but you know what I mean? Like I don't, like, what do I do? Like, how do I change my situation though? Like, how do I get out of living a miracle life? You know what I mean by a miracle life? How do I get out of living a life where every month I need God to do a miracle for me to survive? Okay. Here we go. Tap your neighbor and say, neighbor. You ready for this? Now, I need you to hear me all the way through. If you hear me all the way through, I promise you it'll bless you. For those of you that don't struggle financially, this, some of this is not going to be for you. Thank you for coming. You know, be strong and support your neighbors. But I'm for the next 30, 35 minutes, I'm about to talk to people who are struggling in here financially. And so, yeah. Y'all ready? Okay, here we go. Here's the first thing that you have to remember. And again, we went over this. Generosity is not about what? Amount. It's about attitude. So this is about the way that we think. It's about the way that we think. The first part of the verse, and three times through this verse, he says this. He talks about this. He talks about grace giving, or he says, I want to share with you the grace that God gave to the Macedonian churches. In other words, grace is when God gives you what you don't deserve. And so because the Macedonian churches had a heart to give, they had a heart to actually do God's will in giving and support God's work. Because they had a heart to do that, God gave them what they didn't deserve. In other words, the Bible says, and it's interesting when you read it, because it says they gave to the best of their ability. And then the very next part of the verse says, and beyond their ability. How in the world can you give $10 if you have eight? Right? How can you do beyond your ability? You can only do beyond your ability because God has a way of adding something. That's the grace. He gives you what you don't deserve. You cannot, and I need for you to understand this, especially if you're struggling financially, you cannot remove the supernatural power from how you handle your finances. Right? The struggle with rich people, and you'll see it all through the scriptures when Jesus deals with poor, with rich people. The struggle with rich people is that rich people often have, and again, there's nothing wrong with being rich, but the struggle oftentimes with rich people is that rich people have abundance. But what ends up happening is they begin to transfer their trust to the abundance. Like, when you think about it, when God was forming a people for himself and he went and got Israel and delivered them from Egypt, there were certain things that God told them to do. And one of the things he told them to do when they crossed the Red Sea, they were complaining about eating. Because they didn't have anything to eat. And they were like, and people were saying, well, we should just go back to Egypt, right? Listen to them. We should go back to slavery. Why? Because at least over there we could eat good. At least over there we had something to eat. But now, God, we're out here with you and we have nothing to eat. So you saved us so we could die. So then God said, okay, here's what we're going to do. Every morning when you wake up, when you walk out of your tents, there's going to be bread on the ground. It's called manna, right? And so Here's the rule for manna. When you go out, get enough for the day. Don't try to gather a week's worth. Why? Because the next day, I'm going to do it all over again. So the only day I'm not going to do it is on the Sabbath. So on the day before the Sabbath, gather enough for 2 days. And, you know, we got to trying. So, because it's poverty mentality, right? And so they're going out, and then they see it, and it's everywhere. So you got folks grabbing it, and then people are trying to stuff and grab for 2, 3, 4 days because they don't believe that more is coming. And as soon as they stuff it away, they wake up the next morning to go get it. That stuff got worms in it. It's all molded. It's jacked up, and they can't eat it. Now listen, God led his people for 40 years this way. Every day you go out and what you need is going to be right there and only get enough for today. What was God teaching? What God was teaching is that you can trust me to take care of you every single day. Which means this, that if you don't have abundance like rich people, don't feel yourself less than rich people. Because even though they have enough for 10 years from now, they can only consume enough for one day. Which is about what you're about to consume, enough for a day. See, here's the reality. For some people have all of their stuff and they're good for the next 10 or 15 years. For others of us, you're good for the next 10 or 15 years, but you're just going to get it day by day. And what God is trying to teach us, what God was trying to teach Israel, is that you rely upon me and you never stop your reliance upon me day by day by day by day by day. Is everybody clear with me so far? All right, now, here we go. So, here's what I need for you to see. What do you do? How do you get into this grace of giving? If you have nothing to give, how do you get into this grace of giving? Here's step number one. Step number one. Step number one. Step number one. Here we go. Start with a percentage or an amount you are comfortable with. And then gradually move up. Very simple. Everybody, let's say it together. Gradually move up. Now, listen. Some of you, you're not at 10%. You're just, and I wouldn't recommend it for you. Just being honest. And as churches, as pastors, we've got to be more considerate of our people. Because we don't require anybody to be instantly mature in any area except when we start talking about giving. And that's not what this church is. Listen to me carefully. If you're not at a 10 percentile where you get, some of you, you're good, you are. Some of you are above that, that's cool. But if you're not there, don't in the name of trying to be spiritual, jump out there. No, the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, we grow from faith to faith. And so here's what we do. There was a young lady at the last church I pastored, my first church I pastored. I was teaching a class, and I taught on giving, and she heard it, and she came up afterwards crying. And I asked what was wrong, and she says, I hear what you're saying. I want to do it. She said, but Pastor, I'm not there. I can't. I want to, but I can't. That's a cool part when you have a desire to do something. And you're, so I told her, I said, here's what you do. I said, what are you comfortable with? She says, right now, given my situation, maybe 1%. So I said, okay. I said, let's scale it back to a half. She said, and I said, are you cool with that? She said, oh yeah, I can do like a 0.5%. I said, okay, cool. So I said, just do that. And I said, what you want to focus on is consistency. Consistency. And she gave 0.5% consistent. And I told her, I said, now, after a couple of months, I said, just add a little bit to it. And every couple of months, add a little bit to it. And every couple of months, add a little bit to it. At levels you are comfortable. After a year, I checked in with her and I said, hey, remember we talked? She was like, yeah, yeah. I said, how are you doing? She said, Pastor, I'm at 33%. I said, are you serious? She said, Pastor, she said, I started at the 0.5%, right? I said, yeah. And she said, and I was giving it. And she says, and whenever I got paid, I took the money and then I brought it and then I gave it. And then she said, and then like I realized, like, because it was only like $10 or $15. She was like, I realized I wasn't missing it. And so, like, I just tried one time. I said, I'm going to just double it. And then she said, so I just came in, and then I was like $30. And then she was like, and it was a trip. Like, I didn't even think, I wasn't even missing it. And she said, and I did it for a few weeks just to test it out, to make sure I wasn't tripping. And she said, but no, I wasn't missing it. And she wanted, listen to me, when I tell you she walked that thing up to 33%, why? Because what, see, here's what I need for you to understand. What God wants through your giving is your heart. That's what he wants. And so what God did for her was as she gave 0.5% and then she started to give more, she realized she wasn't missing it. And what she didn't catch until later is that the more that she gave and she wasn't missing it is because God was covering her on the back end. And so fewer things kept popping up she needed to pay for, right? And then she got some other things that happened where extra money was being sent. And this whole thing began to grow, and God began to grow her faith from step to step, from level to level. And she, listen, she not only became a tither, she became a giver. She became a giver because 10% could not stop her because her heart's desire was to give what God wanted her to give. And so that, she got to the point where sometimes she would come in and she would tell me, she was like, ooh, pray for me today. And I was like, why? She said, because I'm feeling God telling me to give my whole check, so I'm finna do it. And she would do it and I'd be like, how'd it go? And she was like, I'm good. Step by step. You pick some place that you're comfortable. That's the seed principle. It's the seed principle. Is everybody with me so far?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. And now, for those of y'all, you know, y'all got money. I know, it's boring. But listen, folks in here struggling, y'all eyes like this. See, because I need to free you. Because especially if you've been in the church for any length of time, you probably have felt some type of guilt because you're not at the level where other people say they are. Now, I need you to understand that. The average giving in any church in America is that 4% of the people attending the church tithe. So everybody perpetrating. And everybody's perpetrating because we don't give people the steps to grow properly. And so what we do, we overcompensate with our praise and our worship. We overcompensate with what we do in the church because we think that if we give more here, that'll make up for not doing what we think we should have done over here. And what I'm trying to tell you is just because you don't give 10%, God is not mad at you. Your life is not cursed. You're not, that's just not where God is with you. That's not where God, that's not what God wants for you. What God wants for you is to grow. So the peace, the attitude, right? Here's the attitude. The attitude you need is not give a bigger amount. The attitude you need is to give a consistent amount. Because what God is looking for is your consistency. Are you, everybody with me so far? Yes? Okay. All right, here we go. So start. Man, I'm running out of time already. Y'all stop with the time. Start with the percentage you are comfortable with and gradually move up. Now, there are three ways you need to do this. There are three ways you need to do this. Here's step number one. Step number one, prepare your giving. Prepare your giving. Prepare it. Get it ready early. Right? Get it ready early. What you want to do is you want to get your, you want, whatever you're going to give, you want to get it ready early. In other words, what you give should never be decided when you get here. You missed it? I'll give it to you again. What you give should never be decided when you get here. Let that sink in. What you give should never be decided when you get here. It's in the preparation. Give an example. Lachelle, your anniversary's coming up. When's your anniversary?
May 31st.
May 31st, that's her anniversary. May 31st comes around. Sorry. May 31st comes around. And Jay wakes up on May 31st and Lachelle has his gift nice and wrapped, wakes up,
hi baby,
because you know her voice is really high.
Hi baby.
And gives him the gift. And Jay is like, oh, thank you, baby. Opens it up. Wow. And then she's like. And so Jay is like, put your clothes on. And she, put my clothes on. Woo! We finna go. We gonna get a car or something. We gonna go. And then he like, come on, let's go. And they go straight to Sun Valley Mall. And he see, y'all already know where I'm going. Right? At this point, right? So Jay walks her into a store in Sun Valley Mall, and he starts looking at clothes. Ladies, what is her attitude at this moment? Listen, so I don't know who said it. Somebody said stank. because see, a part of a love relationship is not what you give me. It's what you prepare to give me. Are you with me? The preparation is as big as the gift. Nobody wants a last minute gift. Everybody wants to know that you've thought about me a month ahead of time, 2 months ahead of time. You were thinking about me. I was going in your mind, and you took out some time and sacrificed some space here and there, and you went and you thought enough about me to know what I like. You paid enough attention to know what it is that I wanted. You paid enough attention to know where I was lacking, and you picked out something specifically for me that fit me particularly based upon your love for me. And I could tell by the gift that you give. Believe me, it ain't so much the gift. It's the thought behind the gift that counts. Because if you take me on the same day to get the same gift, I'm not going to be as excited rather than knowing that you did it beforehand 2 and 3 months early because I was in your mind. Here's my question. How deep is God in your mind during the week? How grateful and thankful are you for God during the week that you can't wait to get here to give him what you've already set aside and prepared to give him? See, here, the problem with many of us is that we are not real givers. Many of us, we give the way we shop. You missed it. Many of us, we give the way we shop. Me, when I shop, when my wife shop, and I still don't like going with her. But here's what both of us do. We walk in the store straight to where what we want.
Right. And look at a price tag.
Get it? Straight to the counter, drop it, run the card, and I'm out. Why? Because we have thought ahead of time what it is that we want. Now, some of us, here's what we do. We walk in. Oh, and we shop emotionally and we spend, listen, sporadically based on how we feel. So we don't shop with purpose, we shop with emotion. And many of us give like that. Many of us don't give from purpose. We give from emotion. So as long as a preacher say what I like, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So as long as a church sing what I like, yeah, yeah, yeah. So as long as the church goes in a direction I like, yeah, yeah, yeah. But, and it has nothing to do with God. It has everything to do with you putting on the performance that it pleases me in order to get me to give to you. It's consumer Christianity. Watch this. When you prepare what you're going to give, see, and I got to help y'all because, you know, you may go to some other services and you may not be here at PFBC, so I got to help y'all. Whenever you prepare to give before you come, that is what lessens the guilt when somebody comes back and says, we ain't raised enough. God is telling me there's 10 people in here who got $100 and I need you to give me $100. Brother, the Spirit is leading me to you today. Right? Right? Listen. See, you avoid the shenanigans. Why? Because you have already made up. You've spent time with God before you got to church. And because you spent time with God before you got to church, God has already instructed you what you are to give. Now, when you get there, if you feel the Holy Spirit leading you to do more, you are more than free to give more, but you're not required to do so because you already got your marching orders from God. Therefore, there's no scare tactic that can get me, and I'm not going to feel bad or guilty or be moved to do something that I wasn't need, that I wasn't prepared to do in order. Listen, church. Listen, preacher. Your emergency isn't mine. And I know because there's preachers who watch this, they'd be like, man, Coleman over there messing it up. No, just tune us out. I'm protecting the people God has given me to protect. See, here's what you got to understand. A worship service is an exchange.
It's an exchange. And if we don't see it as an exchange, we get into this weird relationship with church. It's an exchange. You come to receive something, but you also come to give something. And I'm not just talking about money. I'm not saying this is transactional. What I'm saying is, prepare your offering, but that's only one part of worship. You also need to prepare your praise. No, you missed that one. You also need to prepare your worship. You also need to prepare your greeting. See, when you come in, this is give and take. It's give and take. When you come in, there's something that you need. There's something you need from the praise team. There's something you need from the leader that stands up. There's something you need from the message. But listen, when you come in here, there's a lot of needs represented here. And there's somebody else who was going through a tremendously difficult day this week. And as they were coming through a hard time this week and they came in here, what they need is they need to see you praise, because your praise will rub off on them and change how they think about their situation, and they will get caught up. Listen, that's why David says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together." Are anybody with me? Because other people need your praise too. They need to see it. They need to observe it. They need to feel it. They need to watch you develop an atmosphere of a relationship with God, because they've been feeling disconnected. And if they can get caught up in your atmosphere, it makes life much better. Somebody needs a hug from you today. You don't know what people have been going through. Somebody needs a smile from you today. You don't know what people have been going through. Somebody needs to be greeted by you today. Don't leave it to the greeters. Every person in here, you are on the greeter team. Greet somebody when they come in, because they need it from you. It's give and take. It's drop off and pick up. That's called doing life together. Everybody with me? Doing life together. Can I? Last Sunday, we got word Kobe Bryant was killed. He and his daughter, seven other people, in a helicopter crash in Los Angeles. Internet has gone crazy. Everybody talking about it. Everybody fighting over it. Lots of things being said. In the middle of that, our own brother Karan lost his son last week. And when he comes in here, he needs as much attention and love. He needs somebody to be sensitive enough to look at him and say, something's happening. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Yes. This is give and take. He told me in the week that it happened, he called me, I talked to him, and then he said, "Pastor, I'll be at church on Sunday." Now, I'll be at the men's group on Wednesday. And this is what he said, because y'all my family. I need my family. I need my brothers. You understand what I'm saying? It's give and take. And so the first Sunday after his son passed away, he's at the door welcoming people in and greeting. He's giving. And what he also needs is for us to give back what he's given. Are you with? Do you understand what I'm? This is give and take. It's about attitude, right? Okay, I got to hurry up because y'all are rushing me. Okay, here we go. All right, here we go. Number B. Second thing you need to do is prioritize your giving. Prioritize it. Got to prioritize it. Number one, you want to prepare it. Number two, you want to prioritize it. You want to prioritize it. Now, let me help you understand the mind of God about this priority thing. Look in your on your handout, Exodus 13:2. Consecrate to me every what? Firstborn male. The what? Of every womb among the Israelites belongs to whether man or animal. Numbers 15:20 and 21. Present a cake from the first of your ground meal and present it as an offering from the threshing floor. Throughout the generations to come, you are to give this offering to the Lord from the of your ground meal. Numbers 28:11, on the of every month, present to the Lord a burnt offering for two young bulls, one ram, and seven male lambs a year old, all without defect. Nehemiah 10, moreover, we will bring to the storerooms of the house of our God, to the priest, the of our ground meal, of our grain offerings, of the fruit of all of our trees, and of our new wine and oil. And we will bring the tithe of our crops to the Levites, for it is the Levites who collect the tithes in all the towns where we work. Exodus 23, bring the best of the soil of your house to the Lord your God. Second Chronicles, as soon as the order went out, the Israelites generously gave the of their grain, new wine, oil, and honey, and all that the fields produced. They brought a great amount of tithe of everything. Nehemiah 10, we also assume responsibility for bringing to the house of the Lord each year the of our crops and every fruit tree. Proverbs 3:9, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the of all your crop. Matthew 10, do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Come on, Jesus, call peace. For I have come to turn a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be the members of his own household. Anyone who loves his father or mother, what? More than me. If I'm not first, is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Jesus says, I came to be first. And listen, and I came to cause problems in your house when I'm not first. Oh, you missed it. Because if some people in the house view me as first and other people in the house don't view me as first, that's going to cause some issue when it comes down to how you live your life. Because some people are going to disagree with what you do and what you say, and other people are not going to be happy with what you do and what you say, because we are going in two completely different directions, because we're following two different leaders. And Jesus commands that he be first. Matthew 22, Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all of your, with all of your, and with all of your. This is the first and greatest commandment. Revelation 2, you have persevered and have endured for my name's sake and have not grown weary, but I have this against you, that you have left your. Did you get that? What God's mindset is that he would be first in your life. So what does that look like practically? What does it look like practically? Here's what it looks like. Everybody has a system of how they manage their finances. I don't know how you manage yours, but everybody has a system in terms of how they do it. But here's what it looks like. However you manage your finances, however you determine whatever it is that you're going to give, here's what you want to do. Let's say that you get a check for $100 and you plan to give $10, right? Let's just say. And you have other bills and other things that you need to pay for. Okay? Now, listen. Before you pay the other bills, take the 10 out first. Listen, this is a, it's a mental exercise. If you plan to give 10, what you do is before you honor anybody else, you remove God's portion first and either set it aside or you give it. Now, because you guys are smart, here's what some of you are saying. What difference does it make as long as God get his money? Here's the difference. Jay, Lachelle, y'all up front, so I got to use y'all. Come on. And I'm almost done, trust me. Well, I'm not, but I am today. Okay, so. All right, so. All right, here we go. So let's say Jay turns to Lachelle and he looks her deep in the eye and then he tells her, he says, babe, he says, I love you deeply. Babe, you mean the world to me. Baby, you're the air I breathe. And he says, baby, you're the syrup on my pancakes. Baby, you my one and only, my number one. Nobody before you. And then she responds enthusiastically, oh my God, I didn't know I meant that much to you. Baby, thank you. Oh my God, I've never been loved like this before. And then she says, baby, I am hungry. Listen, let's go get something to eat. I am starving. And then he goes, okay, cool. Let's go get something to eat. But hold on a minute. Let me make sure everybody, let me make sure nobody else needs me first. And then we'll go. So Jay leaves her and starts making his tour around the room, checking in with everybody. So he checking in with everybody. He dapping people up. You know what I mean? He's giving hugs and encouragement. He's letting everybody know that he got them if they need him. You know what I mean? He's going from the back to the front. You know what I mean? From the front to the back, side to side. Checking on everybody, making sure everybody's good. You know what I mean? And Lachelle is waiting, and it's 20 minutes, and Jay is still checking on folks. And he's making sure everybody's good, everybody taken care of. And it's 40 minutes then going by. But because he's dedicated, and he wants to make sure everybody else is cool. So an hour goes by, and Lachelle is still waiting. And Jay is trying to check to make sure he didn't miss anybody. And after an hour and 20 minutes, Jay makes his way back to Lachelle with pride in his eyes. And he says to her, come on, baby. Let's go. Let me go feed you. And now Lachelle got an attitude. She got a big attitude. And then Jay is a little befuddled because he's trying to figure out why you got an attitude. I mean, what's the problem as long as you get fed? Isn't what you asked me to feed you? Why you got an attitude when you finna get what you asked me for? Do you see the problem? Yes. When We give God what we have left versus giving him what we have first and wonder why. What's the big deal as long as God get his money? At that moment, we're making it about money. Because it's not about money. It's about attitude. And God wants in all things to be. Y'all with me?
Yes.
All right, I'm done for the day.
So
thanks. I'm not going to give you C because there's a whole other explanation to C.
See,
come see me next Sunday because, hey, listen, that C is about to bless your life too. Listen, that when I tell you that C is about to bless your whole life, trust me, you don't want to miss C. Matter of fact, in preparation for next week, here's what I need you to do. If you have some outstanding debts, bring your statements with you. Some of y'all are funny. You ain't saying nothing but a word. All right. If you have some outstanding, I'm not talking about your bills. Right? Not talking about your bills. You got PG&E. I ain't talking about that. Unless your PG&E is behind. If you have some, don't be thinking, you know, Coleman told us to bring our bills. The church finna pay all our bills. Like, listen, pay your bills. All I'm saying is, if you have some outstanding debts, car notes, student loans, credit cards, I'm going to exclude mortgages, and I'll tell you why next week. Medical bills, IRS. If you have these things, these debts, these bills, bring that stuff next week. Yeah, just bring it. Wheel them on in here. Just. All right. Okay, we good. All right. Father in heaven, we thank you for blessing us to be here today. We thank you for your love, your grace, your kindness, and your mercy. Lord, I pray that you would please continue to speak to our hearts. Allow the words that you have spoken to go forward deep into our ears, into our hearts. Let us think through what it is that you are saying and have said and make the necessary changes accordingly. I pray, Lord, that next week as we show up with the burdens and the bills and the struggles that we're strapped with, that you would do something supernatural for next week. Father, I'll put it before you this week, but I'm asking, Lord, that you would touch us, not just to hear it and then not do it, but allow us to participate in this process so that we can become more of who you want us to be. We love you, God, and we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen.
Pat.
So if you heard that word today,
always remember Jesus, always keep him on
Christmas. Bless you, Pastor. We invite you, once we dismiss, to come on up, and we are willing to touch and agree with you. We're willing to speak with you. We're willing to pray with you. If you want to learn about the church, we're willing to share that with you as well. All right? We're going to dismiss you. If you stand, going to give you your benediction and release you all to go enjoy the rest of your day. If you have a neighbor, grab them by the hand and say, now unto us who is able to keep us from falling and to present us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and power, dominion forever. Amen. You are dismissed.
Brothers and sisters,
thank you for watching.
Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter.
Remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel and like and share on Facebook. See you next week and have a blessed week.
Love nobody but you.